There's something you want to do down the road, but I was with the 27 superintendents last week, and we're the only ones that start at 7.
Really?
The other board meetings start at 6 or 6:30.
Wow, that'd be tough for a lot of board.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying, I'm just saying, they're all like, what? You guys don't start till 7?
That's a good point. We can talk with the board. I mean, we set the times, you know, whether.
Madison starts at 6.
They also go to 1 or 2.
Yeah, they go to 1. Well, I mean, we could start at 6:30.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would be.
A bit of crimps our agenda.
I remember when we used to get those targets.
Because we do.
Kind of have it into a nice routine now.
There was a couple that was just to be able to talk for 5 minutes.
There's no extra.
They have no idea. You don't do your best work.
That's the same. I'm good with it.
Yeah, because then you're not here another night.
Yeah.
And I'm usually sleeping.
Yeah, let's do it. All righty. It's now being 7 o'clock. We'll call the meeting to order at this time. And introduce the board members, Ann Bauer, Linda Yu, Kurt Karbuski, Paul Kenny, myself. Oh, Kelly Coucher, my apologies.
Wind blew me in.
Annette Ashley, Superintendent George Mayrolis, Annette Ashley, Sean Hyland, Todd Smith, Sherry, and Lori Ames. So at this point in time, I'd like to start with the approval of the minutes. Regular minutes for approval of regular minutes of November 6, 2017.
Second.
Any questions, any concerns, anything needs to be pulled? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And again, just for the audience and everybody thinks, right now, in terms of the ability to access the board agenda electronically, it does not exist. So the board tonight is working via paper. So if you are trying to access it at this particular point in time, you'll be unable to. So at this time, communications. Start out with citizen comments. Does anybody here wish to address the board? Anything on the agenda or without the agenda? No? Okay, correspondence, board communications.
On what night was that?
November 30th.
Kurt and I attended the high school basketball game, and they honored the state athletes of swimming and diving, girls cross country, and girls golf. So that was a really great event. It was a good game to be at, too. Huge crowd. And then I also wanted to say, if anybody is so inclined, this Friday is winter tea at Sunset Ridge, and I think it is also at Sauk Trail, if I'm not mistaken.
And then we have West Middleton is tomorrow. It's a busy week for winter teas.
Right, so if you're so inclined, head out and see some artwork.
Besides the awards presentation that Ann mentioned, I had a chance to go to the Glacier Creek 6th grade band and orchestra concert on November 28th, and I was genuinely impressed with the quality of the music and the amount of hard work that the teachers and the students put in. It was a very enjoyable concert.
The dates have all kind of meshed into my head because it's been a while, but I attended the Harvest Feast at Elm Lawn and had a very nice meal with my daughter and all the other kids there, and I want to thank staff for a very well-organized and well-run and fun and celebratory event. I also visited Glacier and Park, and I also want to thank the staff, faculty there for making me feel welcome. I got to see, I'm not going to name it exactly correctly, but at Glacier they have something called, something like a wall of positivity. The kids post a positive statement, which I think I'm going to start in my home with my junior high school aged kids. and also at Park, I was there just in time to catch some square dancing. Mm-hmm. So it was pretty exciting.
Molly B was there.
Sure.
And before we go any further, I know this has been a little bit, actually, you're here in your alter ego as a school board member. You've also been named a super lawyer, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right.
Really? Yeah, so congratulations.
Congratulations.
What was the word?
It's a super lawyer. It's a recognition from your peers. Oh, thanks.
Congratulations. That's
awesome. Matt? Actually, I have a couple things to report on. On I think it was Saturday, November 18th, the boys' cross-country team had their end-of-the-year banquet, recognized the team for a great season. And the team went on to compete in the nationals this past Saturday. I don't remember how.
Oh, I didn't.
16 out of 22.
Really?
Yeah.
God.
And the
nation mode.
The other thing that was very interesting was there were only a few schools, there's a lot of hybrid teams that come apparently, and Middleton was one of the only ones that had a complete team from a school.
Wow.
It's not as common at that level. So, and in doing so, I think they were much higher when they looked at the teams that came in and that. I think they were more on the upper finishers, so, yeah. The thing, I wanna just take a moment to mention one more thing that I was thoroughly impressed as a parent who had someone participating on the team. I was very impressed. The coaches actually rotated and ran with all the groups, regardless of what their speed was, where they were kind of calibrated along the training groups. They rotate and they run to get to know all the kids, which is a really great method for them to work those, you know, to set up that training. So kudos to them, and it was a good season. The other couple things that I wanted to mention, last week was kind of cool thing. The high school band programs had middle school musicians coming in, and then like the jazz bands and things like that actually performed. So it's a great way to open the eyes of the middle school kids coming in as to what kind of high school opportunities are there. Just a great way to use talent at both levels and put them all together. And then the jazz band was invited to the UW Jazz Festival, which was just this Saturday. And they only invited Madison West, Memorial East, and then Middleton. So another great opportunity for them to work with the professors and clinicians down at the UW and learn even more. So.
The only thing I'll add is I attended the high school's the government and politics class, the committee hearings, the morning, I think that was last week, and I enjoy that. Program's the second time I've had a chance to observe it, and those kids, they do such a great job.
I forgot one thing. I wanted to say thanks to Lori, because I served St. Thanksgiving lunch with her at Sunset Ridge, and she was there in her hairnet scooping up stuff. I should have. But much appreciated.
The whole, all of the different dinners at the various schools, they went up as so long.
I just one other thing I forgot too is last night, I think Kelly saw it last Thursday night, was the screening of the movie Screenagers, which was put on by the SRO from Cromery and Glacier Creek. And very, very eye-opening documentary for anybody that's got young kids or any kids of any age, really. It's and even for adults, it's just it was a fascinating look at how screens and cell phones are. I mean, that's, you know, no news; we all know that. But it's it really gave some kind of experts that talked about some of the long-term effects that things it does to the brain, and but also ways how parents and schools and students themselves can actually manage their screen time. And there were some really cool ideas that I gained as a parent as far as trying to manage, you know, to achieve that balance. You know, it's stuff that's part of our life. It's not going away, but then we really have to be intentional and deliberate and conscious of how we manage our time with these devices. So anyway, it was a good, if you get a chance to see it, I highly recommend it.
Okay, further comments? Kelly, anything? Okay, thank you very much. Actually, it's actually very amazing to me. You listen to each board member talk about all the things you want. I just want to thank the board for being as involved as you are. It's certainly a compliment to the district that you're doing what you're doing. So thank you for that. Superintendent's report, George.
Thank you. As I mentioned in the weekly update, and several of you have emailed, we're really pleased that the school resource officer at Glacier Creek, the funding was approved by the Cross Plains Village Board, and I want to give my gratitude to the current village board for approving this, to Chief Jansen for his tireless efforts in promoting it in the village. And on our end, I really want to thank Bob. Bob has been working on this for many, many years, first with Don and then you know, with me, with other boards that in Cross Plains that weren't quite as supportive. And Bob's been at many meetings and working it. So I just wanted to say thank you for all the work you've done on that.
No worries. It's something that Glacier Creek has needed. I think in many ways Glacier Creek has higher needs than Cromery does in terms of for an SRO, and it's been badly needed. And as a background, I used to serve on the police commission in Cross Plains, so I was very familiar with the situation and how that affected us, so. But it's been a long process, and, but it's been a whole group thing. Obviously, the ability of some of the things that you were able to do, George, and some of the package and incentives, and then just our ability to keep working in a very positive manner that really helped us to get to this point. So, you know, the next step for getting Glacier Creek into its place where we would like it to be. So, thank you.
Yep, thank you. Also, it's going to be a heavy dose of facilities planning coming up. We have our core meeting tomorrow with EUA and Findorf. I have a meeting with the co-chairs Wednesday morning to prepare for next week's board meeting, where we're going to have a long facilities planning report and discussion. And then we have another facilities planning meeting the very next night on the 12th. And so we're kind of in that crunch time now. December, January is going to be very, very busy with facilities planning. So I just wanted to get you ready for that. And also tomorrow, Bob and I are going to go to the city council meeting here in Middleton. And I'm just going to do a public address. I don't know if some of you saw, you know, there were some questions as why did the school district change their mind and whatnot. And so I just want to go and clarify and also reiterate our desire to continue to partner with the city. And it had nothing to do with, you know, some of the things that were brought up. And so I think that'll be very positive. So I'll be there tomorrow night. It starts at 7:30. Joe Parisi is speaking at 7:30. Mike Davis thought public comment would be about 8, but I think I'm just going to go at 7:30 and listen to Joe. So 7:30, if anybody would like to just be there.
Please.
So, thank you. That's it.
Okay. This time we're going to move to the consent agenda. I offer up for your approval at this time 5A, 1, approval of bills payable, 2, approval of treasurer's report, B, approval of resignations, and approval of staff appointments, and approval of retirements, and then also district consent items, approval of a $25,000 donation. We did have a question on concerning, brought up by one board member concerning one of our staff appointments.
Oh.
Well, that was one of the things that I brought up.
And I, did you want me to?
Yeah, just briefly, since we had one person had a question, and we might as well bring it up.
And then, did you hear anything from Tabitha?
I hadn't had a chance to email her.
So I don't know why it was placed that way, but there were some that it showed, let's see, I got to look it up. Nathaniel Hedke and Thomas Schmidt showed long-term sub and then reappointed. Is that's because their licenses had expired from DPI, and so they could serve as substitutes, but they could not serve as teachers while they were finishing up their requirements, and so that's why it was recorded that way. So they didn't change their position, but when their licensure became permanent, then they were considered regular contract again.
Actually, I had known that before because you had answered the question at a previous meeting. My question was, can we as a board approve something for a period of time that's already in the past? And so we're approving their previous appointment to cover what you just described, but
we've actually done it a number of times.
We did that one earlier.
Okay. I remember when it was on the last time, I asked the same question and he explained.
Okay, so we approved that one earlier. I think they just put them together in case people are wondering, why are we hiring Tom Schmidt in December?
Gotcha.
And, I think she just did that to kind of tie the two together.
Okay, gotcha.
Thank you.
And then also, before we move forward on the other, the flexible seating, evidently the flexible seating, and we speak to that as well. Is this type of seating that's found at Cromery and Glacier Creek in the collaboration spaces.
Soft. Similar kinds of seating, flexible seating. I don't know if you're going to do some bounce chairs or...
I met with Barbara Calder on today, and so she was showing me, and I've been at Cromery and Glacier Creek, so we're going to get like a whole bunch of samples to come in and have teachers and kids use them. And like, I mean, it was great, because she really was like,
okay, so at this point in time, I'm looking for a motion to approve the consent items I presented.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any questions, concerns, any items that need to be pulled? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Passes unanimously.
That's you.
Sorry, that was not an opposed.
Okay, we're going to move into 6A, Mindful Education Update.
All right, I think Sean Highland said he would be willing to introduce.
Yes, Betsy Delzer will be talking about mindfulness throughout the school district with the teachers and with the students. I know that there's a number of other people that are joining us. One of them is Ms. Otts from Park Elementary, as well as my daughter, Zoe Highland.
So I have the great privilege of doing the rest of these introductions. So Zoe, as Sean said, is our student voice. Super excited to have her here. Brenda is now at West Middleton, but she's going to be talking a little bit about her experience as a fourth grade teacher last year in the park. Katrina Creek, obviously you guys know Katrina, sharing from the leadership perspective. Clint Steigenberger. Is that right? I got it. Woo, I was like, can you phonetically sound that way, Blake? So he's coming for our high school voice. And Lori Wood, occupational therapist, coming for primarily middle school, but she's at our middle schools and high school. And I'm Betsy, and I'm the mindful practices specialist. So I'd also like to just say hi, my parents came tonight.
Oh, okay.
Brad is back there. Now you'll know what I do all the time. So thanks for being here. Is it okay if I just kind of stand and move around a little?
Please, yeah, please.
Good. So I'd like to start this time with just an opportunity to arrive, okay? So there's a rainstorm going on outside, and this is a long day for all of us. So very often in some of our meetings and in our classes, we take just a moment of pause. So I'm actually going to just invite you to just let the sand settle a little bit, take a couple of deep cleansing breaths. And just notice for a moment just how you're feeling in your physical body, noticing if you're feeling awake and alert or a little bit foggy here at the end of our day. And as you drop into your breath and notice the depth of your breath, just see if you can notice any calming that comes along with that. Thank you. So to begin this portion, you know, I was really excited. I've been working on the agendas for these meetings for a while, and I have been really excited about this time that we have together. So as much as we have things coming up and other tasks at hand, you might be recording things or working on devices, just really welcoming these voices that are making this movement possible and engaging as much as possible for your own good, for your own benefit. And so one of the things I'd like to do, I handed out a post-it to all of you. And the very first thing I would like to do before we dive in and get into some of the logistics and some of the moving parts of this great big machine, I'd like for you to think about a teacher, or perhaps a school staff member, that at some point in your life had a positive impact on you or your story. I'd like you just to think back. It might be a long, long time ago. It might be someone in college, I was thinking, George, if it's a super lawyer, would you be a super
intern? I don't know. Never won, so I wouldn't know.
So go ahead and take a moment to think of this person's name and maybe their face even. And if you can just jot the name down on that post-it. Go ahead and just jot it down. Person's name in view as we're talking. Okay. My guess is that the name that came to you, or perhaps, you know, sometimes when we're prompted this way, we have this like mental Rolodex, right? Which sort of shows my age. But, you know, you just can sort of file through all these names and faces. And for some of us, something comes up right away, and a face comes up that you still hold very dear. And my guess is that this person is a part of your story because of a way that they touched your heart. And so really, the essence of the work that I see that I'm doing and that I see that I'm a part of is connecting that heart back into the classroom. You know, what our teachers come into the field for is not necessarily like a profit margin or stock options, right? Like, in fact, I was driving here thinking about this part of my talk, and I was thinking, we kind of like bleed money all over the place in education when we're devoted teachers, right? And I have 15 years in the classroom, so this is my 17th year in the district. But the reality is, along the way, sometimes for a variety of circumstances, we kind of disconnect to that mission or the reason we came in. And I think the reason we come to this field is because we think we can be some like voice of change or influence, right? And maybe because we love kids, right? love. So I see the work of mindful education and mindfulness is just giving people the opportunity to dial back, pause, and connect more to their hearts. We can talk a lot about student engagement and what's going to happen with how we can raise the level of engagement for our kids, and I really truly believe the foundation is connection. Because if you have a teacher, and you're going to hear from some of them tonight, if you have a teacher who's really connected inwardly, taking time for the interior landscape, they're going to be able to intuitively know what the room needs, and they're going to be able to meet those needs. And then the kids respond. That's what I saw in my classroom all the time. Incredible love. So it's really the heart of this work. And we have a video, actually, that we're going to show you really quick. Can everybody see this screen?
Mm-hmm. George, can you make the one with the light for me? Sure. Oh, MB's got it. Computer volume, just to be. But nothing in technology is working tonight.
That's a bad thing.
Yeah, you just bumped the mics up is what you did.
Yeah, you turned the mics up. Okay. Well, we will love to share this link with you eventually. And sorry about the especially because it gets a little window into Brenda's classroom and she's here to talk next. So this is our 4K programming, and they're just talking about how using movement and a mindful moment every day in their classroom really helps kind of gather their attention as they're arriving. And this is Brenda's classroom, Zoe's classroom from last year. And so they're gonna talk a little bit more about this, but what we're seeing is a yoga practice, and they had these practices that kind of came in a routine way. As they were kind of transitioning, they did multiple practices a day. So they're gonna share a little bit more about that, but I'll just pause this here. And the rest of the video shows, let's see, after this one, it goes into middle school. We have a French teacher, and you get to see some practices in the French classroom, and then in high school, computer science and chemistry classes. So it's really nice because it's just 4 minutes, and DeKruger did a great job of giving us a window to share what's happening when speakers are working, right? Mm-hmm. So, all right. So from here, I would just love to tell you a little bit about why we prioritize this, right? So the reality is that there's a stimulus and there's a response. And Viktor Frankl says, you know, this power is in the pause and in that space between. So for instance, when I was a teacher, one time I had a student pick up a chair and throw it across the room, okay? So that's the stimulus. My response doesn't happen simultaneously, right? So the more that we pause and practice, just like we did tonight, just dropping into our breath, the more we cultivate the power to respond more thoughtfully, so that we're not just reacting, right? But we're actually cultivating the power to respond in a way that's aligned with our intentions. How do I want to show up in this school day for my students? How do I want to show up as a leader? How do I want to show up for my staff members? Knowing our core values, and then every time we have something that comes up, an email, maybe a difficult conversation, a student throwing a chair across the room, we get more and more able to really respond thoughtfully when we cultivate the practice. Just tuning in, knowing what's rising up in our bodies, and then we're not just reacting, and we're not living in that fog, but we're really living with a sense of clarity. Okay? I wanted to make that clear as well, because George has shared some of your interest and inquiries about mindfulness. What is it? There's so many working definitions. What we're trying to do, we often say the goal is, or the vision is opportunity, and the goal is pause. Okay, so the goal is just pausing, just stepping out of the frenetic pace for a moment so that we can give students the option to self-regulate, gain skills in self-awareness, build our tools of becoming empathetic and compassionate. This is really emotional intelligence training. My work primarily this year has really been focused with our leadership team. And so I do a lot of work one-on-one with our leaders. I also coach our teachers and staff one-on-one as well. Okay, so I've kind of blended and created a coaching cycle that's 4 to 6 sessions. Based loosely on mindfulness-based stress reduction, Jon Kabat-Zinn's mindfulness training, and Fleet Moll's mindfulness-based emotional intelligence training. So then I meet with staff members one-on-one and customize the information that I'm giving them based on kind of their needs, their interests, their experience, and background. It's every single meeting is a little bit different, but I keep a thread that I can kind of come back to with this loose curriculum. In addition to that, I oversee all of our OMIA teams. So OMIA is a curriculum I developed in the 2014-15 school year, just taking care of my friends. Like, I was a teacher still, I was teaching yoga in the lunchroom, and I went to my principal at the time, Roz Craney, and said, hey, we want to do more than just yoga. So what if we did gratitude practices and reflection practices at staff meetings? What if we could build in more of that time to draw inward during the workday, right? Kind of pulling out of the mundane rhythm of some of our meetings and making it matter a little bit. He gave me green light go, and we developed something that then I took to every location in the 16-17 school year and trained a small group of volunteers. And many of these people here tonight are, actually, yeah, all of you guys are OMIA leaders. So they then sustain this program, drop-in meditations, meditation Kickstarter course. These are all things that our staff has readily available, just right there, right? Yoga and then gratitude as well. So those are kind of the quadrants and components of our OMIA teams, and I oversee all those teams. And then in the classrooms, right? So I also go into the classrooms, and those also look as different as each little ecosystem. So some classrooms have routine practices, like Brenda's, you'll hear a little bit more about. And some classes are just curious about following the breath, the body, and compassion practices. And so I coach and help teachers bring those practices in. What we know after our time working with the Center for Healthy Minds at the university, they came in and did some study of our kiddos at Cromery. and some of the unpublished, but new news is that they're definitely pointing the needle toward the efficacy of these applications and practices in the classroom being directly connected to the teacher's personal practice. So if the teacher has a personal practice that's solid, they're embodying the practice and the presence as they come into the room, that's going to greatly increase the likelihood that this will make a difference in the classroom, which is why we're so invested in providing these opportunities for our staff. Okay. All right. Well, I can't wait to let other people share in what's going on. So up next is Mrs. Ox. And Zoe.
So we had a special year last year. Our school year started off a little bit rough in that it wasn't a common, peaceful classroom. There were all different reasons for that, and we know a lot of times that when we see students exhibiting behaviors that are disruptive in a classroom or are unkind toward others, that there's something deeper going on, and that was the case. So we started learning about and practicing mindfulness in the classroom, trying to understand what the research shows, because it's great to share with children why we're trying things and what we, what might be possible for us. We started out small, and it was really very interesting to see what happened in the classroom. Started with some breathing and noticing, students noticing their emotions and how emotions come and go quickly, just like our thoughts come and go and sensations come and go. And we became in tune with what was going on in the classroom and sharing with each other how we were feeling about that. So started out maybe a couple of minutes a day doing some breathing, and then students began to ask at times when things seemed a little unsettled or if we were having trouble focusing. Different times during the day, students would begin to request a mindful minute. We would stop and breathe, and we also would reflect about how we felt after our breathing exercises. It was completely optional, and at first there were some students that participated and some that didn't, but most of them would listen to the reflections afterwards and find out that it was helpful for some kids. And more students started participating in the different activities that we were doing, which would take just a couple of minutes here and there throughout the day. In the fall, at some point, some of the kids in the classroom started requesting that they would like to lead some of our mindful minutes in the classroom. And we did a really great variety of practices. Sometimes we would count our breath or notice sensations in our bodies. And so they started taking a shot at it. And one thing that was fairly powerful in the classroom is that when we would have time to share, students would come back to school on Monday morning, for instance, and say, I had an experience on the weekend and it was really stressful. I paused, did some breathing, and they would share some successful moments that they had had where in the past they might have had bigger problems. Students would share that they had a difficult evening and were having trouble sleeping, and they used their breathwork and were sleeping better. So I wasn't soliciting these sorts of comments or reflections. They just started happening. And it snowballed, so to speak, where, by halfway through the school year, everyone in the class was happily participating in our mindful minutes. If we had days, which you could ask any teacher, if there's indoor recess and if you don't have quiet scheduled on that day, the day is going to be particularly challenging because kids haven't had an opportunity to run around, get fresh air, exercise. on those days, we would take additional time. And it made a positive difference in kids' ability to participate in class, to focus. And also, I just feel like they just became a compassionate little community through these practices. Fewer unkind words, just more open-minded. And then we decided that it was time to spread the word. So they started offering to lead mindfulness outside of the classroom and throughout the school. And the teachers and other classrooms would ask have the students come. And honestly, almost anyone in my classroom almost any one of them was comfortable going out into the school community and leaving a classroom in a couple minutes of common breathwork. What did you feel about last year's school year?
Well, it wasn't as, crazy as this school year's, I guess. Mainly third grade was the year where it was very jumpy and everyone wanted to do everything at one time. So then when I went into Mrs. Austin's class and we started doing the mindfulness, it got a lot more calm in our classroom and it was a lot more enjoyable. But in fourth grade was by far the biggest.
If it was time to be quiet and to work, students weren't able to be quiet and work. And sometimes kids would come in from recess and there might have been an upsetting incident at recess. And they would take a few minutes. Pause and breathe, and then they were able to get out of their school and let go of whatever what was bothering them. And I know that kids have a hard time with that, so adults letting go of something and getting back to work and not sort of revisiting things that have been upsetting. I think one of the things that I really felt was really important is that they found a way to take us outside the classroom and into their lives. I'd like to think that many of them still have these tools when they're running into difficult situations or situations that are where they're noticing that their emotions are rising. I think they have the tools to calm themselves down.
I would leave, and in fact, George got to visit this classroom with me last year, but I would leave, and every time I'd have, like, tears stinging my eyes. You know, it's like, this is amazing, just what they were able to cultivate in the community. So we're going to get to experience a practice from Zoe as we close, but thank you so much for sharing, you guys. So now we're going to transition to middle school, and Lori.
Yes, and again, I'm Lori Wood. I'm one of the occupational therapists in the district. I work at Cromrie and the high school in Clark Street. But I am on the OMIA team for Cromrie. And when we met, we really chatted a lot about what information we wanted to bring back to all of you to really show what's going on in our building. So we opened it up to staff and wanted to hear from whomever would feel comfortable in sharing what they're doing in the classrooms. And I think the beautiful part about it is you'll see a variety of ways that mindful practices are threaded into the school day, and teachers really choose what, you know, what they feel comfortable with, what resonates with them, and what works for their classroom setting.
I think I'll just communicate a little bit through
The slides. Cindy Sandershank
is one of our school psychologists. She works at Cromrie and Glacier Creek.
I know I I had a mindfulness group with her last year during our extended learning time with a group of students, and it was a wonderful experience. And she uses the practices almost daily with students in a one-on-one situation as well. Daniel Barini, one of our seventh grade special education case managers, she has a pull-out special education math class, and she teaches this class right after lunch and recess when a lot of conflicts may arise, and they do a mindful practice, and it's a beautiful transition into their math class. The mindfulness cart has been a new addition to the building. Fred Bartman, one of our school counselors, he meets with a group of sixth grade boys, and they do some mindfulness together as a group, and they have a cart of yoga mats in which they can use to use some of the strategies. A mindfulness corner, this is one of our fifth grade classrooms. Both the teacher and the students put this together with a yoga mat and yoga cushions and made it a really calm, safe space that they can go to for a quick break. The wellness bingo, one of our teachers, Mercedes Martin, she does this right about now, so right before winter break when kids are a little ramped up, and she lets them do a bingo game where they can do mindful strategies like, you know, breathing, walking, reading to someone, and things like that. She rewards them with a prize. And then gratitude practices. This is how we start all of our staff meetings. It's a nice way to just drop in, reflect on something you're grateful for in education before getting to the staff meeting minutes. And our reset room has been a staff favorite in the building. With Betsy's help, we were able to convert a small space in our building with, you know, beautiful cushions and lighting, and staff can go there for 5 to 10 minutes during their day just to reset, do some breathing, drop in, pull up a mindfulness app, and things like that.
I believe this is for
ICON, too.
Correct. First and foremost, just want to thank you for this opportunity and space to come into your world. I've been in the district now for 15 years as well. Teaching health and physical education at the high school, coach basketball for many years. I've had some of your children in my classes. It's a beautiful community. I'm extremely thankful to be part of it. Betsy, I think, mentioned before, sometimes as a teacher, you know, you're so excited and you're always thinking forward, but yet it's really difficult year after year after year to kind of muster up that same level of energy. And a few years back, always pretty good at taking care of my body, but as far as truly taking care of my mind, it was almost too foreign. It seems so simple, but yet too foreign. And it wasn't something that just happened overnight, but I think slowly I started to practice. I started to recognize sometimes that practice was pleasant, sometimes that practice brought me to a place of discomfort, sometimes it brought me to a place where I was just kind of there and it was neutral. Really didn't have a strong feeling one way or the other. I think as human beings, we always want results. And I think you are in a situation where you do some amazing things in front of our community, behind the scenes, but yet we're a results-oriented industry with education, you know. And I think sometimes with mindfulness or meditation or breathing practices, you know, we sit down and think, oh my gosh, I want something. And sometimes it's too much effort we're putting into it. You know, when you don't necessarily put that effort into it, it's like, wow, you start to feel it. And it's really difficult one to explain, but once you feel it, it's something that you just kind of keep searching for. So thank you for that opportunity. So at the high school, we do have an opportunity to actually run through a curriculum. And it's one of, I'm sure, many that are out there. It's one that, if done with integrity, gives you a chance to go through the educational pieces behind mindfulness, also the neurological backing and support behind it. There's a lot of flexibility for individuals. We currently have it in our freshman health, foundation of health class. So pretty much this year there will be over 500 plus students that will have an opportunity to explore it. It's not something like in force, so you really just invite them open to the space. just something, you know, to take away, you know, something, you know, each day there was our goal that we put out there, some from the program and some that we had just in our own personal practices. This is one that speaks to me. So I will speak to you continually from the top of my mind, but really from the bottom of my heart. This is just one example of many, but there's always kind of a key point, essential message, and some class objectives. So it kind of provides a little bit of structure and focus, but yet it provides for each individual to kind of take what they need. But I truly believe that it kind of feeds off of you at the elementary level, just trying to give them some tools in their toolkit to be able to say, you know what, maybe I'll give this a shot, maybe this is something that I can keep exploring, and hopefully it becomes kind of that healthy habit. So this is kind of the closing, or getting towards the closure of it. But it really does focus in on the body, reflections, thoughts, emotions, pain, attention, stress, anxiety, social and emotional learning is a huge thing. Habits, and then trying to empower our kids to be able to do what they can do. So I've been really thankful to have this opportunity to explore. This is just one thing that we do at the end of the program. Basically, each student creates a little bit of an artwork, and on that artwork, we put it together as a quilt, and everyone's definition is different. That's why I think it's really tough to wrap down one definition. So we just let them, what was on your mind while we practiced some of these things? What were some of the big takeaways that you had from that? Or what is something that you just, you know, experienced, and you got pretty much everything under the sun there? But it's really unique, and the kids kind of, you know, feel like they have some ownership in that experience as well. This is something that we just started this year, just to get some data, something that just is kind of trying to encompass what we're trying to work on. And we know that this might not be life-changing in the moment, but we're really impressed with the numbers that we had, 144 responses thus far, so we're still in the initial stages of it. But we just wanted to get some information. So I'm only going to highlight four of those real quickly. And again, this is a small sampling, but something that I was taking back, but I really didn't think and know what I was going to get to. But you can look at the prompt there. It's something that I thought was pretty impressive. These are freshmen, so 14, 15-year-olds in our district, dealing with a lot of stuff. I'm telling you, there's a lot of things going on in the world. Academic stress, living up to the expectations of others, home life, disruptive home life situations, you name it. A lot is going on. But just this idea of being able to deal better with stress in their life, nearly 65% said that that was something that they kind of took away from this program. And it wasn't forced upon them. It was just a practice that they had. I thought schoolwork, as a school board, you're probably interested in that. But over 54% said that they're able to manage that a little bit better in their course of this semester. Managing emotions that are upsetting. You know, I'm a father. I'm a very happy-go-lucky individual. I'm a 4- and 5-year-old. One sound that really gets to me is that kid that's like, you know, like over whatever it is that they're getting to. And it's really amazing because I find myself being more reactionary than I need to. But when I hear that sound, or when we hear the sound of the speaker before we hear any sound that kind of goes off, you know, it's not chasing it. It's just trying to ground yourself, and it's trying to say, you know what, it's there, I recognize it, and just move from there. So that's kind of a personal practice that has really helped me. And I'm not perfect dad, but yet it is something that I try to carry over from my personal life to my professional life. And then I think one other one I wanted to mention was just being kinder to themselves. You know, I think we're all our toughest critic, but man, oh man, to see, you know, 56 plus students in that quick survey say, you know what, I'm taking a moment to be kinder to myself. I mean, that's not me. That's not just the few people that are doing that at the freshman level. That's all of us. That's all of us in this community. That's starting at the young level. It's students that are taking this stuff to heart and finding meaning to it and just trying to bring it to yourself first. And then hopefully that can just kind of carry over to others as well. Thank you.
Well, I think we've probably exhausted the time on the agenda, right, George? But I wanted to give Katrina a chance to talk about leadership just a little bit.
Sure.
Okay.
So I'm, you know, y'all know I'm new to my lesson. And I heard about, you know, mindfulness practices coordinator and all that, but to see it in action is a pretty unique thing. And when I chat with people who I know who work in other districts, their jaws literally drop when they hear like what the district has for staff. And I feel extremely blessed because I mean, I'm going to be honest with you guys, if it wasn't for Betsy, I don't know if I would have survived last year. So I took her up on the coaching that she talked about, and it was fantastic. I have like tried to do mindful practices for probably 20 years off and on and off, and I'm still trying. Like, we're all trying. It's a journey. But to have someone that that I could, you know, talk to, and it was very grounding. And the other really great thing too was that she could help look through the lens of my school as well. And so, like, one of the things that she had like told me to do was like to take my staff picture of all the staff on a thing, and just like look at that in the morning with holding loving kindness in your heart for the staff. Like, so starting my day where I'm focusing on the people in my building, and I'm focusing love and gratitude for them, and it grounds you, because you walk in that door and it's on, right? There's no subs, the bus is late, you know? And so for me to be able to take that is like, I can kind of come back to that. And I think West Middleton's mission is a compassionate, collaborative community, and those compassion practices are huge. And we talk about that, whether that's as adults or whether that's as students. So that's huge. And then, you know, when we talk about, a lot of teachers say, I want an AP curriculum and I'm just going to do it with my kids in my class. Give me a curriculum so I can do breathing with my kids. It doesn't work like that. Like, you really do have to embody it. And once you do, it comes organically. And what I would say is that's been replicated at the district level, because, you know, George's thing at the beginning of the year was model the way, and George models the way around this. Like, you can feel it in his energy, and you can, and the way that meetings have been run. And so, like, we start all of our leadership with some kind of a mindful practice. And what's cool is now that's being, like, how that was being shared by the kids, now it's being shared by us as staff, and different people are taking that over. We're doing a book study, Real Happiness at Work, which is a fantastic book. It's actually a book I've wanted to read for probably 8 years and have not read it. And so now I get to read it for work. And when I have told people that, I'm like, yeah, this is my book study. They're like, are you kidding me? You get your, that's the book you're reading. It's not like data-driven, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, no, it's like about taking care of myself. And then I'm ready to do the work and do that. And so it's been, for me, from a leadership perspective, you think about as a team and how that really affects us and helps us, that emotional intelligence is huge, right? Like, you know, kids can read and do math, but if they don't have strong emotional intelligence, they will never keep a job. They will never stay in a relationship, right? And so those skills, to me, are the most important skills. And we're cultivating those as leaders, and then I feel like that's then trickling down to our staff and our students in our school, and it's been pretty awesome. So I think I hit most of those.
So we're branching out a little bit to family members and community as well. In a mindful parenting class, we bring in a parenting expert for that, and. Just in closing my piece, if you have access to this eventually, or if you have access to this, I inserted some resources. I know some of you were curious just about learning more and maybe even have some questions of your own. So please feel free to contact me. I'm here for you as well. And if you just ever want to see clearly, we could go on for, like, this could be a whole day-long retreat together, right? We're just giving you the 30,000-foot overview here. But you can see we're really embedding some of these things into the roots and hopefully opening the heart. So that's really what we're about. And to do that, I would love to just close this time. Thank you so much for the time. Sounds like the storm has died off, and you don't have to worry about the speakers buzzing at us too much more anymore. But thank you for this opportunity. And Zoe, are you ready to lead us in a practice? Okay. I'll hand it over to Zoe. Thank you so much.
And thank you all, and especially to Betsy, who's kind of been our, who has been our shining star on, in this movement, so thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we move on to a district and school council report cards, I want to go back just a little bit. I remember when George first decided to become superintendent, he presented to us his agenda and the things that he wanted to do. And then he spoke to everybody, had the band, the whole nine yards, and you laid out your platform. And implicit in that platform was just what was talked about here today. Really unusual, I think people have been part of organizations, to see when a new leader comes in and within a year and a half, their vision is fully integrated into the system. It's not often that you see that, but yet I'm seeing that right now. And we're also seeing the positive effects that come from that and the change in the way the organization works. So my thanks to George for supplying the leadership. My thanks to the people who took that vision and moved it and integrated it into our school district, because there's obvious benefits to it, and we're just beginning to realize those now. So I want to thank you for that. Thank everybody who's participated in this.
Yeah. Bob, thank you all for participating. Great job, everyone. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Ooh, now we got to get to school report cards.
Yeah. No, you know, but on the one thing, it did make me realize just how frantic we all
right.
are in our lives, because
right.
we're all busy people. And just the slow down and the pace for me was almost fighting it. So it was nice to go through that exercise. But now you get to ramp us back up.
These are great news, though.
We won't ramp up too much. We're,
okay.
We're pretty good. I'll keep a good pace. And I'll keep it brief, because I know you've had the chance to read Perry's article, you've been able to look at all of the report cards that were linked. I'd like to focus a little bit about how we use this information and how the report cards are compiled, some of the calculations behind them, and then we can go through some questions, because I think that's kind of the piece that doesn't often get communicated, and people often have questions on how are these put together and what are they for? So I'll go through that and then we can go through some questions briefly. But the purpose of these report cards, they're not based on the data that drives our instruction daily in the classroom. They don't tell the whole story. They're a piece of the puzzle and serve the purpose of what DPI, the Department of Public Instruction, needs to put together in order to meet state accountability requirements for accountability reporting and how they compare schools and districts and their performance. So it's put together with that lens to fulfill that purpose. It's very public data, it gets publicized quite a bit, but it's not the full story and not the only data that we're looking at, because it doesn't tell the whole story. So it's a piece of our data pie, I always like to say. As far as the purpose, the report cards are put together kind of like through, I like to think of it as like through a filter. Like I can take a picture and then sometimes I can put a filter on it and the picture's there, but it might have a different tweak to it or how it looks. That's kind of what DPI does with the data in order to meet certain requirements for accountability. So it isn't a pure look at test data or attendance data. It's looking at that through a lens based on the calculations that they have. Some of that I described in your packet for how they do some of the calculations. There are weighted averages and variable weighting, which I think is important and sometimes is often overlooked. So when they're looking at data calculations, that overall accountability score is based on the priority areas of achievement, growth, closing gaps, and looking at readiness for post-graduation and post-graduation. But it's not a pure average of those four areas. It's a weighted average, so various areas, achievement and growth, have different weights than closing gaps and on-track for post-secondary readiness. So that's one thing to keep in mind when you're looking at that information. The other piece to keep in mind is that there's variable weighting
for achievement and growth based on a school's demographic composition. So the more or the larger the population of economically disadvantaged students that a school or district may have will affect the weighting for their achievement and their growth. So growth will be weighted more heavily than achievement in that situation. So the higher population of economically disadvantaged students a district or school may have, the higher your growth score will count for your overall priority score and vice versa with the achievement. So for example, in our district, Sauk Trail, their achievement and their growth areas are almost equally weighted based on their student population. Some of our other elementary schools, lower populations of economically disadvantaged students, their achievement is weighted higher than their growth. And that's based on legislation that happened with Act 55 a few years back. So that's another thing to keep in mind when you're thinking about that. That's kind of those filters I like to think about. The other thing to explain is some people assume that the district report card is an average of the school scores, which is not the case. So when a district is getting its report card, it's kind of like a big school. They run all of the calculations based on the school district population. So it isn't an average of West Middleton, Sunset, the high school. They rerun all of the calculations. So variable weighting is different because of the district size and so forth. So another point I like to explain to people as they're looking at that, because sometimes people assume it's an average of the school scores. In our eSchool, 21st Century eSchool, and Clark Street also have an accountability process. Theirs looks different. It's based on internal data and reports that Principal Gertner has to compile. She has to monitor progress and submit that to the Department of Public Instruction. So when you see their report cards and it says alternate accountability, satisfactory progress, it's based on data that she has to provide because their cell sizes for students at their state-tested grades are too small for them to run adequate reports based on these formulas. So that's something that she goes through an accountability process providing data to DPI. So I like to explain that as well. The other tricky thing with our report cards is that when possible, DPI likes to use multiple years worth of data, which is a wonderful thing, but we went through some test changes. We had WKCE. We went from WKCE, as you recall, to the Badger exam a few years back, 3 years. And then last year and the year before, we had the Forward exam. So in some cases, we also had to move with ACT data in there for the high school level. So in some cases, with some of the priority areas, we have 3 to 4 different exams and their associated data in those calculations. So it just makes the data a little bit more volatile, which will even out over time as we're sticking with our Forward exam that is here for the foreseeable future. But keep that in mind as you're looking at some of this data. In particular, it affects the achievement area and the closing gaps area, because some of that data has up to 5 years worth of data in that. And I think that was all the notes that I had. I wanted to keep it brief and kind of get more into the background and then open it up for questions for you if you have specific questions. I guess the other thing I'll point out before I do that, now I'm going back at myself, is that it beyond the overall score, we look at that, but we really, I mean, as I said before, this data isn't necessarily what's driving our day-to-day instruction in classrooms or school improvement reports, but we do look much closer at the subsets of data and the priority areas. So we really look at growth, we really look at closing gaps, and we look at the overall score, but really, in that DPI's advisory,
well, just taking a real quick glance, by the way, I like the setup that we have here, where you're able to take a glance across and look at the scores over a six-year period, actually five, with one being done. And it is nice to see the improvement. And I do find very significant, you talk about the scores and what we need to do as a district to work within the scores. But unfortunately, we live in a world where, as we're a destination district, most of the parents only take the time to look at the scores.
Mm-hmm. It's very public.
Right. So they have a tendency to live and die by the scores. So the fact is, as we're looking across here and seeing our scores from 2011 to 2016-17, regardless of whether there's changes made in the exams, regardless of whether there's things from an outside looking in perspective, the district is doing very well. You know, but I like the fact that we're taking apart the reports, not sitting on our laurels and working forward, making sure that we get better each year. And obviously we have places for improvement. But, you know, without knowing, like, you know, as an example, Katrina deals with West Middleton, you have the highest of the highs and you have the lowest of the lows. And you get graded based on that gap between the two. So if somebody was to be looking at your score, they wouldn't understand the criteria that you're being judged on.
I just tried not to take it personal at all. Say, just come in our school and you'll want to stay. So, but it is, we have kids who are extremely high, at lots of kids in the advanced end, and then we have kids here, and we don't have a lot of average in the middle, which is a pretty unique situation. So,
but this score, because it was spring of last year, kind of reflects a lot of what was going on at West Milton before
right.
Katrina came, and you know, some of the challenges that they were facing. And I will bet the farm, I don't care what levels of assessment or what assessments you use, I know these scores are going up because I see it in your classroom. So
the one thing to think about is that this is almost a lagging indicator because
right.
the data is quite old by the time we get it. We did dive into the report card a little bit with the West Middleton staff and looked at, like I said, the subscores and the subgroups of data. And the one thing that we were talking about in particular was their mathematics growth. Their growth score was up from their previous year's score. So while you're looking at the overall score, that's sometimes misleading. When you dive into the deeper area, there were definitely some celebrations there and some improvements from the previous report card.
Yeah, so I think, you know, I've been on the board not a long time, but I mean, I know these scores and report cards get a lot of press and a lot of attention. I think it says something about our board and our district, though, that we don't linger long on these because they are just, you know, one snapshot, one piece of information. And, you know, I think a lot of districts, if they got report cards that look like this, they'd probably do nothing but talk about them, right, because they're so good. So I think it's worth taking a minute to say these are great.
Yep.
I mean, these are great. They really are. But at the same time, we're not satisfied with, you know, we're not stopping because we receive great report cards. We're still here every day trying to improve the experience for the kids. So, I mean, I wanted to just say these are great.
Right.
But at the same time,
really reflect
I
mean, the dedication, the hard work of all of our staff. There's a lot to celebrate, but we also don't want to say, hey, we're wonderful, our report cards are great, and then
right,
you know,
right. I mean,
not
what makes,
do anything after that.
What makes our district so great is so much deeper than this, and so I think it's right that we say these are great, but then we move on because we got other stuff to talk about as well. So,
yeah. But, yeah, go ahead.
What I really liked, and I'm going to piggyback on to Todd's comment, was some of the biggest changes that took place, too. Were very noteworthy for a couple of the schools, two in particular, for Park and Sauk Trail. I mean, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. So just, yeah, great work.
Great improvements there. And if you remember a year ago, I was here talking about Park in particular because they had shifted categories and had a drop in their score, and it was because of the change in calculations, and we were kind of almost calling it a data glitch, even though there were no errors in their report card. It was just the way that DPI was regrouping their students because their student populations had grown. And I said, don't worry about it. It's just a one-year thing. And here we are a year later, and they're back on their normal trend. So there are some
blips like that, DPI acknowledges that with the, that's where I kind of hinted at the volatility of some of the data sources at this time, and they'll become more stable in the future.
Like you said, because they're public, and just follow up with Todd, if you want an elevator speech on a celebration, 5 out of our 6 elementary schools significantly exceeded expectations. We had the highest rated middle school in Dane County, we had the highest rated high school in Dane County, and the second highest district score in Dane County. Now let's move on.
But we're not satisfied.
Right.
But we can do better.
We can do better. Absolutely, we can do better.
Yeah.
But there's a very nice trend line as
yes,
well.
Yes, that's
yeah,
my point.
Yeah, that's wonderful information, but we also know there may be some students who aren't achieving where they could be, and how can we engage with them and really support those students, so.
And then just one last shout out to Sauk Trails. Percentage of free and reduced lunch, was that 54%?
About 40, mm-hmm. right, 41?
41?
Yeah, 40-ish. Right around
43%.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's amazing work being done.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, again, I'm going to go with Todd. We sometimes have a tendency to take for granted that we do well, to acknowledge and thank the efforts of everybody who's done and got us to this point, to look at the trend of where we're at. Like you said, we got to keep working hard and keep moving, you know, further into that. But very nicely done.
And I think, like Betsy and the teachers before me who did the presentation on mindfulness, it's things like that that make Middleton so innovative and unique that really help the scores that we have. It's more than our curriculum. It's our engagement. It's the whole.
Great. Great job, Mary Beth.
Thank you very much, Mary Beth.
Thank you.
Okay.
Now Sherry's going to tell us the because of all that great stuff and because of these scores and because of all these other reasons, what's happening with our enrollment, Sherry?
It continues to increase.
Wow.
Shocking,
surprise,
I know.
Surprise.
So this is just kind of a review on where we've been. And what I'd like to show first is just our last 4 years of data. The red bars show what our actual Third Friday enrollment was. The gray bars are Applied Population Labs projections for K-12 enrollment those years. And so the first trend I would point out is that there's a significant difference between where we came in and what APL projected for us. What you can see then after that is both the ROFRs and APL projections for 2021, 25-26, and 30-31. So if you take a look at that red line, one of the things we were seeing is the trend line was not matching the projections. And so we talked, I think I had shared last time with Mark Roffers, we've done some analysis ourselves, and a couple of things are playing out, we believe. The market is extremely tight here in Middleton, and because of that desirability to find housing, properties are turning over more quickly, and perhaps with a higher percentage of families with children, because there's a desire to move into the district. And so it's not just the new buildings, it's even in places like Elm Lawn where there is no additional housing being built aside from that apartment complex over off Parmenter, which was not a huge number of students. We're seeing increases in enrollment, right? Large fourth grade class leaves, and that's being more than offset by additional students moving in. And so when we asked APL, Lori asked APL, one, to update their projections earlier than they normally do. We typically get new projections each December. We asked if, because we're in the FPC process, could we get them sooner? And could they take a closer look at their model? Since this year, they give us 3 different models through which to look at numbers. At every single grade level, our enrollment came in higher than whichever model gave us the highest projection for that grade. And sometimes it was a matter of 2 students. At kindergarten, it was 49. And so one of the other trends I've seen is that in kindergarten in particular, we've been missing the mark, and I'll explain kind of why we think that is. So we asked them, they did update their projection, their kindergarten trend projections. They updated to use a two-year trend because we continued to grow more quickly. And so I want to talk a little bit about what we're using then in terms of projections moving forward. So because our enrollment's been coming in higher, when we look at historical data, the most accurate of their models has been the two-year trend projections. And so that's what we're going to use moving forward in first through 12th grades. At the kindergarten level, APL's methodology is to use 4K numbers for the next year's kindergarten enrollment, but then after that, they use birth rates. Birth rates in Dane County and the state of Wisconsin have been flat. And so what would happen is they would suggest we'll have 495 in kindergarten next year, but then it would drop back down to around 480, and that's what they showed all the way through 27, 28, because their only method is to use birth rates, and those aren't changing. We know it's not the students who are born here that are increasing our kindergarten enrollment, right? It's families moving in before their kids start kindergarten. And so we don't believe it's birth rate that's impacting our kindergarten numbers. If so, they'd be flat, and then our numbers wouldn't be increasing at all the other grades as well either. And so what I did is I went back to 2006-07, and I took all of our kindergarten Third Friday numbers and then did some three-year trend analysis and then also year-to-year. And what we found over time is we continue to increase about 2% a year in kindergarten. And I want to be upfront about the fact that those numbers aren't like a straight even two, right? We have a big class come in, a smaller class. But the trend line of that kindergarten enrollment is a 2% increase from year to year. And so that is what we are using moving forward, because we know our kindergarten enrollment isn't going to be flat when everything else is increasing. So APL would tell us their projections are most solid through 22-23, right? Because it's responsive to recent trends. So the projections beyond that assume that our growth will continue at the rate it's been happening the last 2-3 years. So I explained kindergarten. The other thing, APL does not break it down by school. So we will continue to do analysis school by school, and I've got 4 years of trend data that we're using to project individual school by grade for next year. Again, because what happens is the growth, if our increase is 15 at first grade, they don't spread evenly across our schools. In the last 4 years, 34% of our enrollment growth at the elementary level has happened at West Middleton, right? So we're going to project more of the growth to happen there. So what these updated progression projections then show is, again, here was last year actual, here's this year, and that dotted line going across is our capacity. So you can see what those updated model looks like in terms of enrollment up through 27-28. Again, APL has highest confidence in their projections through 22-23. And all of this assumes that we continue to grow as we have in recent years. We don't know when the market might slow down in terms of building or selling, but if we continue at this pace, that's where we're headed. So updated elementary projections then, you can see how that lays out. A couple things I would point out there is that second grade class next year is that first group we had that was over 500 when they came into kindergarten. And so to read this chart, so here's next year's projected kindergarten, 495. We would anticipate they'd be 534 in first grade, 561 in second. And so cohorts move then across the board diagonally. Does that make sense? So what does that mean in terms of option development? It means by 2022-23, we'll be almost 300 over capacity at the elementary level. Elementary enrollment's increasing more quickly than either APL or Rafferty's projected. And by 2021, options 2A and 2B, the additions at West and Park, would not meet our projected growth. So they would hold until 2020. If we pursued those, that's when we'd finish those additions. At the middle and high school level, again, showing what we would project 5th, 6th, 7th, 8th. And this assumes averages, right? We always get a bubble in some unexpected grade and less in another. You can see the big jump when that current first grade class hits 6th grade and we have that first 6th grade class of over 609, right? Is it that one?
Probably the 698.
The 6, yeah. The
That's
6,
humongous.
23, 24. And then you see the jump again when that class hits high school in 2025. If we continue to grow at that rate, we would hit a freshman class of 800. If you look at the junior class that year, they're just over 600. So you can see that's that bubble class moving through. Our biggest increase from grade to grade is 8th to 9th grade typically, because we pick up students who are in K-8 privates and they come in. So what does that mean at the middle level? It means that option 3, the addition at Glacier, would address growth through 22-23. And then by 23-24, we would need additional middle school capacity. At the high school level, enrollment continues to climb beyond capacity. We'd be at 500 students over capacity by 22-23 without additional action. Option 6 addresses growth through the time of those projections, 27-28. The piece I should have added, on these charts, that bottom line in each level, I just took our current capacity relative to what the projections are at that time. So you can see where the gap is in capacity. And the other piece I'd add is at the elementary level, it's harder to get tight to capacity because we're spreading students out across 6 schools. And so we can't just move a section, we move neighborhoods, which means kids across grade levels. So I think that's it. What questions do you have?
And before we go into the questions, George and I were at the last facility planning committee. When we made this change in the enrollment projection, and rightfully so, because the whole board has been talking about how uncomfortable we were with the Rofford numbers. And the fact you're able to get the APL numbers and show definitively that, yes, there is a trend line going based on solid science that we are experiencing growth. Well, the biggest change that was brought up to us by facility planning was the middle school. That was what they noticed right away. And they had some concerns, and there were some questions regarding some of the board actions, and we'll talk about that later. But I think that's probably the main takeaway that the facility planning had from...
Yeah, they're going to come next week with some questions for you, some thoughts for you, and we'll have a really good discussion. They're going to... we'll wait because it's on next week's agenda. So tonight is just to absorb the numbers, to let it sink in, and then know next week they're going to come with some thoughts, ideas, and questions for you.
That being said, let's talk about the numbers and the questions that you may have.
How did the FPC take it? I mean, with the,
that was my question.
Like they've been working really hard.
So let me, can I address that?
Please do.
You don't mind? Because we're going to talk more about this tomorrow at CORE. We've all said all along that moving a $200 million referendum is highly unlikely that we would go to that level. And so now we're starting to talk about phasing. Phase one was Cromrie when we built it. Now we have to talk about a phase two and a phase three. And so what we may have to look at, and that'll come next week, and that's kind of what they talked about. That's why I'm bringing it up. Is they even say, there's no way we can build 3 brand new schools, basically. So they're like, okay, which would we do first? And then maybe we tell the public, we're gonna do this now, and then in 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, we're coming back with phase three. That's what Wanakee has done, that's what Sun Prairie's done, that as this package starts moving forward and we weigh in on it, think of it as multi-steps is probably what we're gonna have to do.
I would add too, I don't think there was a great surprise. I mean, I think seeing the cumulative effect of those increases might have been a bit of a surprise. But I think because we've seen significant growth and above either the APL or Rofers models, I don't think anyone was surprised that, oh, actually the updated projections are higher than what we had before.
Yeah, and obviously we have to make sure we're confident of our numbers. Nothing mm-hmm. would be worse than if we had gone through with this process only to realize that mm-hmm. all of the hard work and planning that we had all done was not going to, in fact, solve the problem. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you know, kudos for you know, taking the time to make sure our numbers are right. And if it means a course adjustment, that's what it means.
Mm-hmm. And there was a little bit of increased pressure on them because all of a sudden they are starting to run up against a timeline because they wanted to make a presentation to the public on what options we're at. And we kind of accelerated the boat a little bit, and all of a sudden they go, oh, wait a minute, we're there, but really not there. And so they had to re-examine. I tell you, there was some very spirited discussion among the FPC. So, I mean, I think they regard it as a challenge, but at the same time, I think what we had felt all along, they're now beginning to feel.
Has there been any statistical modeling done on the newer figures to see how it, if you were to apply this to previous years, how closely it reflects our actual growth with any kind of confidence intervals?
Because they base it on previous trends, they're taking that trend and rolling it forward, really. And so because they're basing it on what's actually happened, there's not a way to push it back in time, really, but it's responsive to then the last 3 years of data.
Remember, APL looks back 2 years, 5 years, and 10 years, and then they project forward what that looks like based on your last 2 years, your last 5 years, your last 10 years. And as Sherry said, over the last 4 years, the most accurate
has been
the 2 year look back,
particularly at the elementary level.
Yes, but we've still exceeded their projections even with the 2 year look back.
In some middle school grades, the 5 years been slightly higher than the 2 year. There's less difference between them in terms of one being more aggressive. At the elementary level, the 2 year has been much more accurate than the 5 year trends. When I've gone back and then looked at how did they stack up to last year's data, the previous year's data.
Good question, Sean. You got that look on your face.
No, I'm just looking through the numbers and seeing small fluctuations and then trying to understand how, if it's a two-year model that they're building, how are they building in those variabilities in the numbers?
So what they look at really is then the kindergarten class, and then what is the typical growth from K to 1? And then they apply it to whatever the current enrollment is in K.
I'm just looking at K kind of mm-hmm. and seeing that it's not always consistent.
Right. So there, that's going to be more the trend line than the actual students, because aside from birth rates, we don't have a way to predict how many kids are out there.
When kindergarten's always the hardest to predict because they're not in our system yet.
Right. We know what the
biggest
typical increase is from 4K to K, but in the grades where we don't yet have a 4K class, but over time, the 2% has held. The other thing is, before we got the updated APL, I had taken the last 4 years of data, so really three cohort growths, and done a three-year trend analysis, school by school by grade. And the numbers with what APL came out with, you know, were within 20 students, K-12. And so I think, you know, what they're seeing aligns to then what we see in individual schools.
This could be a blessing in disguise to get updated numbers like this, because I mean the numbers and the size of the referendum that we were looking at, I know, made a lot of people nervous.
Yes.
We're always mindful of the taxpayer and the dollars. This may allow us to have a longer conversation about what needs to happen in our community with our schools. Might be a timeline that is, well, maybe not great because it's going to slow down addressing the needs of our buildings and our students,
maybe one that is allows a longer dialogue, I guess.
Any further questions? I wanted to do this a quick sum up. If you take a look around us, you take a look at Verona, you take a look at Sun Prairie, you take a look at Wanakee, around the Madison area, there are, the suburbs are experiencing a larger growth. I just finished reading a very interesting article, and I'm just going to sum up a couple sentences. There talks about the cost and benefits of a vote with your feet system of educational competition. And we are all, being parents ourselves, we all wanted the best for our kids. And many people, Linda, I know other people, have moved into our district because of our schools, moved into the area because of our schools. So we do see a vote with your feet. People are moving to our area because they want to have a good school. The downside of this is the winning areas have to reckon with increased volume and add infrastructure. The losing areas face a downward spiral of home value decline, tax increases, and vacancies that plague inner cities. I think we're seeing that in our area as well. We're seeing that in our neighbors, and we're seeing the increased amount of people moving not only to ourselves, but moving into Verona, moving to Wanakee, moving to Sun Prairie. So that being said, this is not a short-term trend. This is a long-term trend. And as long as we continue to do the things that we're doing with our school district, continue to be an excellent school district, this is going to continue. So each one leads to another, and we just keep moving forward. So right now, this year, one more year, we've had good report cards. We've had good scores. We have good things coming from our school district. We have lots of people who would like to be here. So what does that mean? Our biggest problem is adding infrastructure to house the kids. And then on the other side, once we have the structures to put them in place, do we have the ability to train and maintain our staff? So that's one of the things that the district we've been working on, George's been working on as well, to maintain our quality and our excellence as we continue to grow. So we have the right things in place. So now we're right back. I'm circling back. We're now working on the infrastructure. So when people ask us, are we going to stumble? We haven't yet, and we're going to hope and move forward. But the big stumbling block is going to be making sure that we have the correct capital needs taken care of in terms of our buildings and such that, so we can continue our growth, you know, in a very good manner. Questions on the numbers as you look through them more. Yeah, go ahead.
I was just curious. This is an aggregate number. Is there any way to see this number?
Break it down by school.
By the individual.
So that's what I've been doing. Then okay. Is taking 4 years of data, 3 year trend to project what we think each school will be.
I guess what I was curious as is that the, let's say looking at the different elementaries, it would appear that there is only so much room for physical growth, new homes being built, new apartments being built. I was just curious how this model would complement where there's potential for more growth compared to
so
areas
it's,
that are more.
It's not as responsive to land potential. I think it is responsive to things like, for example, the original Roffers projections suggest that Elm Lawn would drop by 100 students by 2020. Well, we're not seeing a decrease. We're seeing continued increase in a place that's essentially landlocked. And so what we've then looked at is where are we seeing the grade to grade increase? And it really has to be grade to grade, because you can't just look at total numbers, because the size of the class that moves from fourth onto fifth isn't linked to the incoming kindergarten. So we look at its census and 4K enrollment. And so one of the things that we're continuing to see is at the elementary level, for example, Elm Lawn, about 20% of the growth is coming in Elm Lawn, where in an area that shouldn't be growing like that anymore. Right. And so what we've been looking is, what does it look like at kindergarten to first at Elm Lawn versus kindergarten to first at Northside at West Middleton? So school by school then, to say, here's what the trend would suggest will happen at that school. But this is truly just a trend analysis, whereas the Roffers is linked to actual houses, lots.
John, if you could, I'm basing this off of being in the district for a long period of time. I look at Elm Lawn as an indicator of how many people are moving into our district, and that growth indicates to me, because it's landlocked, and that's a turnover. So that to me is how many houses are flipping and people are moving in. I turn around and look at West Middleton because that's right, from the, at least in the past, it's been where our highest potential for growth in terms of homes have been. And that to me, that's an accelerator for what we're seeing for number of homes being built. It's real rough, but it gives me an idea when I look at the two.
West Middleton has both a considerable stock of existing homes and lots that are selling for build.
No, I don't know if that makes any sense, but that, you know, that every time I look at Elmont, I think it's going like, oh boy, it's turning, you know, the market's turning around. So anyway, we'll have some, actually the FPC will be moving forward to the board looking for guidance in the pretty near future. So take a look at these numbers, keep them in mind. But we certainly will have a strong, compelling story to tell the public as we move forward. We're going to move on to VER. Tabitha sent off an email.
Yep, I have it right in front of me.
Okay, good. I was going to say I had it here as well. Okay, if you want to talk about
it. Yeah, so what administration, what I am proposing and administration is proposing is that we extend the voluntary early retirement benefit for teachers and administrators for two additional years. We heard our OPEB report during finance that our investments are doing very, very well because we have a capped benefit and probably a younger workforce. I know we do. Our payments have actually dropped into the OPEB trust based on those factors. And so it's a benefit that I know helps retain our great staff. We have not increased it in many, many years. It's stayed consistent. Even though healthcare costs have gone up, it involves a payment to a health retirement account for teachers up to $92,000, depending on how many years they have in the district and when they retire, along with a $10,000 stipend for 3 years. For administrators, it's $120,000 deposit to HRA, and then a stipend for 3 years based on their years of experience in the district, ranging in that 12% to 15% range per year. So those are the benefits. They have not changed in many, many years. So the reason we're asking you to consider rolling them is this is the time of year people start making decisions about retirement because they have to turn it in January. And so when they know, okay, I can either work one more year or I can retire next year, By them knowing the benefits out a few years, it just really helps them make those decisions, you know, what's best, what's there in their best interest. So that's our recommendation. That's not an approval tonight. Tonight's for information. We'll bring it back next week for your vote.
Now would be a good time if you have any questions on this. George mentioned this briefly in the Finance Committee, but again, because we made this a defined benefit versus a undefined benefit, which means the dollar amount stays the same, it certainly made it easier as we've funded that and made sure that it would be a fund that would stay solvent for us. So, but it's also not one that every school district hires. There are many school districts which have dropped this. So I do know it is appreciated and actually watched by many of the more veteran teachers.
Yep. What questions?
I have a clarification question. So we have a defined benefit plan, and you mentioned other schools, they switch to something different. Is that defined contribution?
No. Well, after Act 10, some schools dropped VER altogether. Some have tied it more to a, what would you call that? Remember compensation that Don had kind of presented?
Right, more of a
Match, maybe an employee match kind of thing. There were
suitcase
all different
benefit.
Things, like a suitcase benefit. The problem with those is that everyone gets it, and so if you leave, you take it with, and so this has been one where you only get it if you stay. You know, people that come and go, they don't get this benefit. And so it's defined in that it's capped monetarily, and it's defined in that you must be here at least 15 years and retire from here. That's the only way you get it. So not everybody gets it.
Okay. So the number of years will be converted to a factor from 0 to 1, right? And then apply to the to their base salary to determine.
Well, that's not what we do. No.
Okay.
No.
So you said up to 92,000.
Oh, that, well, that's that is based on if they work till 60.
Okay.
Then if they retire at 57, they get $92,000 if they had 15 years. If they work to 60, that's three less years, so it's probably $77,000. It's to age 65.
Okay. Another question I have is, what is the current faculty or teachers' age distribution? Do we have more people facing retirement or more people?
We're trending younger.
Yeah, and that would be my comment. I feel like as a parent, I want to see more experienced teacher stay in the district, you know, because of the institutional knowledge and their previous experience. So can I interpret this as if we offer early retirement option, are we incentivizing people who are on the edge of retirement to retire early?
You know, we haven't seen that. People have made, they really have made their decision based on their unique needs and family needs. We do have some teachers that, very few, retire at 55 or 56, which you can do in Wisconsin, mm-hmm. But most are 57 and beyond. We have several teachers that teach into their 60s. They actually get less benefit because if they retire at 62, they only get 3 years worth, but they say, that's okay, I love teaching, this is what I want to do. So I can tell you, just in talking to people and looking at the retirees, in fact, a retiree tonight is, I'm not going to say her age, but I can say that she's been here, you know, a long time and a very loyal employee.
Yeah, you know, I hate to see we are incentivizing, you know, teachers to retire. We want to keep the good teachers as long as we can.
Well, but I think the flip side of that coin is that a lot of teachers who are kind of in the middle of their career mm-hmm. might stay because of this benefit.
Exactly.
So they will get the experience and they'll be here longer to teach.
That's exactly.
Or come here right out of school and then stay for the duration
right.
versus coming in and out.
Yep.
Yeah, but that would be like two different issue, right? One is have the pension there. The other is offer early retirement incentive. If we still have the pension, right, still going on, and we still attract younger teachers to join the district, but the early retirement incentive, it's
enough to help them, but it's not enough to push them over the edge.
And there's still the ETF incentive to work longer to get a longer annuity, lifetime annuity after they graduate or after they retire.
But that early retirement is like an additional thing. We still have the pension.
That's right, yeah. I understand, yeah.
I think it used to be referred to as a golden handcuff.
I heard about golden parachute.
Okay, but same type of situation. You try to get them to stay here as long as you can. You know, golden parachute, but in other ways, by allowing this instead of a portable benefit, by it's something
right.
you have to be here, that's where
you only get it if you stay.
You only get it here if you stay, and that's kind of where, instead of a parachute, it's more like we want you to stay here. Which I think is what you were asking for. You want them to be here longer.
Yeah.
Any other questions? We'll bring this back for action next week. Thanks.
All right, WSB Education Convention attendees. I think we talked a little bit about this before.
Here's what I have. I have Bob, Annette, Linda, Todd, Ann, and Sean. Do I have that accurate?
Excellent.
And it's January 18th.
January 18th at 1:45. Cheryl, you work with Cheryl in terms of what day you want to arrive and how many nights you need and all of that. And then once we have that, we'll book dinners for Wednesday night and Thursday night like we usually do so we can spend some time together.
I'll get the bars picked up.
Yeah, Cleo's again.
What do we got? No, it was...
What was that called? The lights. The weird little lights.
Left me a favorite bar. Why can't I remember?
I thought it was Cleo's.
I missed that one. The one that surprised you?
Cleo's. Yeah, something else.
I'll think it'll come to
okay.
me. Bryant's.
Yeah.
And we were making sure that after the 18th that we were all going to get together after the class was going on, so we will make plan of having a meal together.
And, well, we're going to do Wednesday and Thursday.
Right, yeah. But, no, we're go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say, of the six, is there anyone else that's, I just want to make sure I didn't miss anybody, right? Okay, that's great. I mean, six is an amazing number, so.
Cheryl, we don't have to notice it, because we're not just, we do have to notice it. Okay, because that was the question, yeah?
I said, ask Cheryl, she'd know, I don't know.
So we will have to notice it as a meeting, and that would be another reason for having, because we have more than five.
Okay, well, there we go.
Do we get registration discount, since we have so many people?
No, she said no.
Ah.
If you go one day, you pay the same as going all day.
Then they got you.
And Jerry and Joellen are coming, and they're a part of our presentation on the 18th. And,
hopefully they can join us as well.
Yeah, yeah, we would like for the two of you to stay and join us for dinner if you can as well. We'll talk between them, but since you're right here, we would love to have you.
All righty. Declaration of candidacy. Saw three sheets of paper floating around here, so I do know that we have three different board members who are running at this time, so if you would like
not
to...
Not against each other.
Not against each other, no. So if you wouldn't mind, just formally, Ann, or take it, you are
running. Yes, I am intending to run.
Thank you very much, Linda.
Yeah, I'm very sure I'll hold on to my spot.
And Sean?
I'm running as well.
Okay, excellent. And Cheryl, if we could ask, has anybody called or indicated any interest or asked to take out a paper this time? Not a large indicator, but, you know, it's a couple of days in already. And we haven't heard anything. So good luck to everybody, and good luck with the papers.
Yeah.
And thank you for running again.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, I mean, as George and I both talked about this, as we're moving into referendum, it's nice to have the same group of people as you're moving forward. Not saying that it's the way it is, but the way it's looking right now, it certainly is nice. And the stability on the board is very important. So thank you again for that. We're going to move into action items. First one is 7A, approval of land rental agreement, Pope Farm property. We did discuss this in finance, but there were a couple people here who were not in finance. If you want to present real quickly, Lori.
Farm the land at Pump Farm as a way. We talked about this. It's not so much a large revenue generator as it is someone who's helping to take care of that property and to monitor what's happening. He has been informed that depending upon what happens this next year in November, this could be the last farm season that he has to work with. So he's aware of that.
I motion for approval of the land rental agreement.
Second.
Any further questions or concerns? All those in favor say aye.
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 Those opposed? Approval of Godfrey and Kahn payment. I understand you need
not participating.
Not participating.
That item's deferred.
Oh, it is deferred. My apologies. I didn't get that far.
Still not participating.
Yeah, still not participating. So in that case, it's deferred and handled. Well, we no longer have any other further agenda items at this particular point in time. Before we go any further, are there any potential board agenda items that people would like to move forward with? For, I guess at this point in turn, look for a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Thank you for a good
thank
meeting.
Thank you, everyone.
Yes.
Just a reminder, next week we do have round table. So.
Who is it?
Elm Lawn, Northside, West Middleton, and our internal.
Like